long week, but I think a beautiful week. We all enjoyed the talks and in the morning the beach. And it's time that we quit, right? Because we get later and later to the conference site, I think. But so thank you so much, Alfredo, Marcos, Florentino, and Marcel. Where's Marcel? There. For putting this together. And as it was already said quite often, it's a very interesting group. So I had the privilege to meet this group, I think, also a long time ago, almost as a student or postdoc. And some things have not changed. Other things have changed. And it's also interesting to see that where this has evolved to. So I'm very impressed to learn now that basically semi-classics is applied to true many-body physics. And there's, games going on, mean field games, certainly not mainstream. And other things are just highly technical. This is how, I guess, how the field evolves if you get more and more specialized, but that's also very valuable. So I myself, I'm atomic physicist. I have been always an atomic physicist, and I still am one. And in atomic physics, we have, how to say, the luck that actually the field evolves mostly not, one has to admit that, through the great ideas of theoreticians, but mostly through experimental capabilities which have evolved and developed spectacularly over the last 20 years. So we have now extreme ultra-cold physics and extreme ultra-fast physics in basically atomic physics. So we work in both fields. And today I want to tell you a little bit about what's happening in extreme ultra-cold physics. And this goes very well along, again, with semi-classics, because ultra-cold physics makes very, very small energies controlled. And then we can go to Rydberg systems, where also the energies are very small. The systems are very large and fragile, but one can have them these days in the experiment in ultra-cold gases, BAC, and so on. And one can even make, as you know, almost condensed matter systems by now. But I will stick, also because it's the last talk, and I don't want to stretch your patience too much, to really one electron. So one electron, and I take it over, I don't know, from 1990 to today, so almost 30 years. And you see what has happened to the fate of this poor little Rydberg electron from the days of the 1990s until now. Okay, so let's see if this works or not. Maybe one has... Oh, it's working, yeah, fine. So this has worked together with Matt Eilis. He's a postdoc right now from Chris Green, where he graduated. Andrew Hunter is a new PhD student, and perhaps Luke, who left us already. Again, Rick Heller will know him. He had a little bit of collaboration also with him, but he comes from Finland and got his PhD there. And I was at his PhD defense where I met him and got the idea for some of the projects. And the experiments are performed and have been performed by Tilman Pfau and his group in Stuttgart. Oops. What is going on? Well, this doesn't work very well. Well. Let's do it like this. So here's a bit of the overview, very simple. A Rydberg atom, Mr. Rydberg is on the right, his original manuscript with the Rydberg formula on the left, is, as you know, almost classical, but it provides a very high density of states if you go with n to infinity. That's a singular point in the spectrum. It's highly degenerate. We heard about this yesterday from Holger. It does not only have spatial symmetries, but also dynamical symmetries, therefore this SO4 group. So you have many modes of motion possible with the same energy, and that means a priori you have delocalized wave functions. We are not used to that because we think of the periodic system or things like that where you have well-defined angular momentum and so on, but this comes because the core of basically other electrons in a big atom breaks this degeneracy. And then you have well-defined angular momentum. But you don't need to have angular momentum in a high Rydberg state. You can have anything and a superposition of all these degenerate wave functions, and you don't know how they look like. These are classical Kepler ellipses. There you know how they look like. And if you basically now have, and this was also mentioned yesterday briefly, an S state without angular momentum, that's just a line classically. This is, of course, you have to define it and put it somewhere, and you know you could put it anywhere, And quantum mechanically, we know it's just a symmetric, a spherical orbital. And in the beginning, this is very difficult to understand for students, for myself as well back then. But that's kind of the difference between classics and quantum mechanics. And my talk will be basically how do you achieve or what happens if you have interactions, an environment for this Rydberg electron, which makes a gradual change from its quantum properties, completely delocalized wave functions, into localized distributions or probabilities where this electron actually lives. And of course, it's the interaction which does that. And the kind of traditional perspective on that is if you have a few particles that interaction with perturbations leads for an electron, which is highly degenerate, very flexible, very fragile, it leads to polarization. But in the end, it actually lead to localization. So let's look at this. That's the menu, Rydberg atom with a charged particle, antiprotonic helium, 1990. That was fashionable at that time because they made it at CERN to create antihydrogen. Then Rydberg atom with N neutral atoms. This brings us to the 2000 years where there was proposed that ultra-long-range Rydberg molecules could exist. And then I will talk about trilobites in an ultra-cold gas. That's a condensate. This is around 2010, where this was verified experimentally and actually also shown theoretically that this agrees with what we expect. Now, presently, we have Rydberg polarons. That's a modern language from condensed matter, of course, how you can grasp this. And if you increase the density even more, then I will tell you what happens to the fate of this trilobite. And you will also learn why this is called a trilobite. And in the end, if there's time, I will talk a little bit about the future. This is a Rydberg impurity in an atomic lattice, which all of a sudden acquires, due to the high density of states, kind of band structure and almost a little bit of condensed matter properties. So we just increase the density of the environment of the Rydberg orbital along the talk. Now here, you saw this yesterday. These are prolate spherical coordinates. And this is exactly what I should describe an antiprotonic helium. The helium sits in one focal point, and in the other point sits the antiproton. This is basically a molecule. These are heavy particles. So the axis is adiabatic, and here's the electron. And this separates even for fixed internuclear distances the system. That's the potential surface. So if we fix the electron here and move the antiproton, of course, if the two are together, you have a repulsion, infinity, Coulomb repulsion. If you solve the Schrödinger equation for a fixed distance, this gets smoothed out and you get this kind of potential surface. And if you calculate this now for high excitations, and this is necessary actually if you did this at CERN where you have a capture of these systems coming from far outside, then of course the basically Bohr radius for the antiprotonic hydrogen system, these two, is very, very small, right? But you come in from far distance, and therefore you need these Rydberg states here. And now, yes, you see, this is where we converge asymptotically to a hydrogenic helium plus excited N equals 7 or N equals 8 ion, that all of a sudden, the highest states here, they form another minimum. And that's polarization. That's a very interesting effect. And so, I shouldn't use this, sorry. So what you see, what happens essentially, is we can get two different kind of systems. Qualitatively very different. The atom-like one, where the antiproton is closed by the helium that just forms a singly positive ion. And for the electron far out here in a Rydberg orbit, this looks like hydrogen, like a proton. So therefore, it's atom-like. That's just a Coulomb kind of potential. And the other possibility is that you live out here in this minimum, and that's molecule-like. You have even a barrier which prevents the antiproton from coming close to the helium double plus. Also, I mean, they would attract each other, you think, but dynamically this is forbidden. And how do you see this? You see how this comes about classically. And this is work by our chairman, Klaus Richter. I think this is one of the two papers we have together. You cited the other one. That's the review. You see here, it's 1991 in Freiburg. And so this is what happens. Here's the antiproton, the motion. You have to be very careful. The journals normally tend to just do this, used to take this away because you think it's dirt in the So these days it's electronic, it's no longer such a danger. And this is the electron which now gets polarized here by the antiproton and forms this very nice kind of parabolic, almost parabolic orbit, which prevents the antiproton from falling into the helium, right? Because the electron is negative, the antiproton is negative, so they don't come close to each other, and you see this here as a minimum. This, by the way, is a classical potential curve. That's a classical kind of Born-Oppenheimer approximation, and it fits extremely well on the quantum mechanical curves here, really surprisingly well. But this tells you it's a highly excited system, and semi-classics or even classics is not so bad in this case. So, but the lesson to take away for the next things to do is that the polarization of the Rydberg electron, so the antiproton leads to a localization of this Rydberg electron here in this space. It could go otherwise anywhere. Now, let's see what we can do now. Now we had basically, of course, a neutral system with two negatively charged particles and this doubly charged core. Helium double plus. Question is, can we take a singly charged ion here and create something similar, like a molecule? Of course, this would mean that we also should make basically the third particle the neutral. So, because otherwise it would not be bound with two negative ones, this has a different character. So this is here then, now we replace the antiproton just by neutral atom. Does this still bind? Well, of course, it has much weaker interaction, so the potential looks like here. So, and also this interaction, you will see this in a second, is very, very local compared to the Rydberg orbit, since the extension of the ground state wave function is small compared to Rydberg orbit. So this is the idea. Essentially, this happens now in ultra-cold environments. So unfortunately, Holger, this is no longer separable if this is not a charged particle in the second focus, but something else. But still, it's approximately separable, and you can do perturbation theory since you're highly excited, and basically the perturbation through this ground state atom is very weak. Actually, you can take it, and this is also very old, as a delta function perturbation at the position where this sits, and this the strength basically of the perturbation is a scattering length if you're very cold, which is energy dependent. So you think that your electron comes by in the Rydberg orbit basically as a very, very slow scattering wave, and you can do even S-wave scattering. This is what this signifies here with the scattering length, and you can calculate this then in perturbation theory. That's a setting we will use throughout the talk, so it's relatively simple. And the molecular orbit is now determined by perturbation theory in this potential here from the degenerate orbitals of this high Rydberg, highly excited Rydberg manifold. So this is how a typical wave function looks like. Again, with the classical one, just an ellipse here put in. That's the nodal pattern. You see, you still kind of have this Prolet spherical geometry. And the potential you get automatically, since you have the delta functions, right, the interaction, is almost like Born-Oppenheimer potential, of course, for a molecule. It has these ripples here. And this comes basically from distances where the nodal separation is exact, 3 in the radial direction, 26 in the angular direction, and so on. And in between, it doesn't match so well, so therefore you get ripples. And this thing, Chris Green, who invented this, called trilobite, because you know what trilobites are, they are these ancient animals, so to speak, and they look a bit like a wave function. So when this came out, I was very jealous. It's a great idea to do this and to basically postulate that this should exist. But we asked ourselves then, can one make chemistry with this? Can we actually make really triatomic molecules or maybe polyatomic molecules? So simplest one is a triatomic one. We take a second ground state atom. What would its electron density look like? And this you see here. So you It's very simple. This is actually textbook chemistry, which is never true, but here it's true. You simply take a linear combination of atomic orbitals, one trilobite at R1, the other one at R2, and you have positive and negative linear combinations. They're identical. It's just parity. So this is true LCAO, linear combination of atomic orbitals. And these are the corresponding potential curves. So this would be the dimer.
now you have here the attractive, basically trimer, and here the one with the parity, which is not favorable. And you see where there's lots of interaction of the orbitals, you have the large splitting between the parity states. And the electron density looks like this. You kind of recognize what's what. This helps your eye. So this is one dimer density. That's the other one. And the ground state atoms are sitting here in the focal points. The proton, whatever, the ion in the middle. But what's interesting now is if I overlay the classical ellipses, now you see they really have an additional meaning. And the meaning is essentially that here are the two focal points that belongs to this ellipse. But this ellipse goes through the other ground state atom of the molecule, not the one in the focal point. And this means your wave function has maximal interaction with the perturbation, which gives you the maximal binding. And this is at the minimum point of our potential curve. I will show you that in a second. And of course, for the other partner as well. So this one belongs to these two focal points. It goes through that, basically, ground state atom. And if you see, so that's this point here. Yeah, and that tells you again that localization, of course, here very simply, it's integrable through periodic orbits is very important to basically understand the structure of these systems. Now, the question, many of you have heard this talk already, but you can also answer if you want, because it would be very, you know, gratifying for me if somebody remembers the answer. But anyways, so now if I put basically for an n equals 30 Rydberg electron, if I put ground state atoms on a circle, how many of those ground state atoms will give me the deepest potential curve? My question implies already there is a number which gives the deepest potential curve, which means if you put more, it doesn't really help. You have an idea? Okay, fine. I have to give this talk another 10 times. the answer is 58. And the result is quite spectacular. So because this one potential curve for 58 atoms, that's the excited states, by the way, is very deep. You know, it's a factor of 3 deeper than all the others, basically. And this is, of course, phases. Yeah? This is due to phases. It will become important later on because you have amplitude superposition of all your contributions, trilobite contributions, if you wish. This is how it really looks like. This is taken from another setting. It's actually a very dense lattice. I will come to that. But this really has 58 lobes. Here, this is planar. This is a planar perturbation. Yeah, it's also here. So you put all these atoms on the plane, just to make it simple. Yeah. Yes. So these are basically different eigenvalues, yeah, for different eigenstates. And the lowest one looks like this. I will show you partially. So they are much worse, of course. They have phases and so on. This is why all these energies are up here in the ballpark. That's, by the way, the dimer, the dashed line is the dimer. So it's not much different from the dimer. It's only if you have really the phases adding up coherently, so all your perturbations go into one direction, giving more binding, then you get this deep potential. And this is actually the 58 lobes, here it comes, right, of your wave function. It's a circular wave function where you get the maximum in the plane, and these are the 58 M lobes, if you wish. And you put in each lobe, you put one ground state atom, and then it adds up coherently, and you get this. All right, so now we are already around the 2010, and we ask ourselves, does this exist, this creature? And Tilman Pfau actually proved that, so we have to do now a little bit nitty-gritty reality, which, like always, is not as simple. So this is done with rubidium. It's not so surprising, because rubidium is kind of the harmonic oscillator of Bose-Einstein condensates. It's very easy to generate and to deal with. And you see now, basically, what I haven't told you, there's two different kinds of trilobites. So if I go to very high angular momentum here, then you are outside the core for rubidium, and you really get what I told you, complete degeneracy. If I have basically a Rydberg state which is of SOP character, then you have quantum defects if you have a really deep core. So you lose the degeneracy and only one channel contributes, only the S wave function, which is shown here. So basically the S wave function, you probe this by your perturbation, or your ground state atom gives you directly now the Born-Oppenheimer potential, which looks like that. And in the experiment, of course, they do this by lasers from the ground state of the BEC. They normally get only basically one or two units of angular momentum. Actually, they do a two-step, which means they can reach S or D states in the final state of the Rydberg manifold. And that makes a bit of a difference, but it's not so important, but it's important to know how for the calculation. So this is the scheme, how it's done. You take 780 nanometers, and then you take another one, which takes you up here, and this can tune quite well into resonance. So the idea is simply you shine this wavelengths, this combined wavelengths, into your BEC, and you hope you get photo association and exciting things out of nothing. Let's see what happens. And this is what they found. So this is done for basically different principal quantum numbers of a rubidium. You see here between 35 and roughly 40. And they found very nicely here this state. You can calculate it relatively easily. And they found even the first excited state in this Rydberg wave function, S wave function squared, if you wish, here. But then they found additional states. And they didn't go away. It was not dirt. And they didn't quite know what this is. So after they published this, of course, well-deserved in Nature, they came to us and asked us, do you have an idea what this is? And this turned out to be a 2 or 3 year project because it's really, really horribly difficult to calculate that. Because this was based on a single channel wave function here and just one scattering length. And the truth is, unfortunately, like always, it's Murphy's law different for rubidium 87. Rubidium 87 has a P wave shape resonance. You see this here, so this falls down here. And the black curve is what we would like to calculate. It's here on 100 megahertz resolution, which is, I don't know, 6 or 8 digits in precision, absolute precision of the energy. Now calculate an excited state at n equals 30 with this precision. That's hell. And so this is, this is if you blow this up, it should look like that. That's what I showed you before, but it doesn't. Because you see here, at smaller distances, you have this cliff falling down. You have very interesting effects here. You have internal quantum reflection. That means your wave function does not penetrate in here because it cannot go over this cliff, even if it's classically allowed. But I won't talk about this today. Anyways, how to calculate this is with a Green's function at this energy in the end, boundary conditions, and that's the final result. So you see it's not this regular wave function. Here comes this cliff, and you get actually many more states which also live more inside here. So this is the one they found. This lives so deep here in the well, that's almost unperturbed. It's kind of the same, but the others are different. And now, here's the comparison. It's almost like quantum chemistry, nice table, but it was so hard to get this table, so I have to show it to you. This is the experimental spectrum, 2 different final channels, doesn't matter right now. So here, you really see the peaks. That's the atomic peak, and of course, I mean, redshifted because it's bound, the molecular systems, the dimers. And you see here, comparison, measurement, and theory. You don't get everything in every channel, doesn't matter. But we systematically did not get certain levels here in theory. But what was really surprising, they saw the trimer right away. So even with this one photon, they actually also generated triatomic molecules. That's this energy here and this green stuff here. So you see this in the energies. They compare quite favorably. And of course, it's very easy. You simply double the energy because there's no interaction between the ground state atoms. So just double the dimer energy and you get this from here to here. And after this was published, sometimes you need a bit of distance because it was, in the end, it looks simple, but we had to really work hard and get scattering lengths which were not known and so on. Of course, it's very simple to think what these missing lines are. If you take this with the trimer seriously, then you have basically a vibrational quanta, right? The trimer is just vibrational quanta 0 in each of the bond lengths. But of course, you could combine excited states of the dimer, B1 and B2. And if you do this, you get all the other values just for nothing, just for free in the end. So basically, they also saw different excitations in the bonds of the triatomic material. This is how they were formed. Of course, it's an ultra-cold gas where the atoms move slowly, and this, then you get suddenly quenched, yeah, by emission of the photon, and you can also get into excited states, clearly. Anyway, so it's proven it exists, and this is now important for what will come. The atomic density was 1.5 10 to the 13th particle or atoms per cubic centimeter, which means that every fifth Rydberg atom volume contains a gas atom. This gives an idea how likely it is to associate basically these atoms into molecules. Now let's increase the BEC density to something like 3.6 to 10 to the 14th, and we make any bit larger. So now we go to a situation where three of the ground state atoms on average are contained in the Rydberg volume. This is a bit what Steve asked. What happens now? The same thing happens. But now you see not only dimers, and this tells you the vibrational state, ground state, first vibrational state. You see trimers with the different excitations in each of the stretches. You see that here, tetramers up to pentamers that we're able to see. And that's, of course, a modern language. They call this, I could call this Rydberg oligomers. The condensed matter people call this, of course, polarons, because they calculate this with the input of knowing how the dimer spectrum is just by dressing the Rydberg impurity with bosons. These are the ground state atoms, yeah, in the presence of a laser. So then you can calculate this. This is very new. It's from 2018, I think. And now we ask ourselves, what happens if we make even the density again higher? So we make it so high, let's say take n equals 50 for the Rydberg orbit, that now on average each Rydberg volume contains 1,000 ground state atoms. What do you guess will happen? Well, we thought this is the situation actually. So here is your ion in the middle, and this is the cloud of ground state atoms. It's just a random, yeah, just rolling the dice with the mean density, the red ones, and this is roughly the size of the Rydberg orbit. Therefore, we only basically represent here the ones in the Rydberg orbit. Now, if I put basically random atoms on a lattice, and I think this is a bit the question which was asked before, Rick, the wave function looks like that. Yeah, it's done, basically, it's gone. There's no more structure. It's pretty random and chaotic. And this is also what we expected initially, because you think you can basically make a dimer or a trilobite with each of these ground state atoms. There's some superposition, who knows, structure is lost. Now the question is, what would you actually measure as a sign that the structure is not lost? And there's one very evident thing which I haven't talked about yet. Of course, if you form this trilobite, it's extremely polarized, like our helium antiproton molecule in the beginning. So it has a huge dipole moment. So you can measure the dipole moment. That's the easiest thing. Even experiment can do this. And we also published this with the V group a while ago. And so let's do that. The observable is really the dipole moment, which kind of signifies the polarization and also localization of the Rydberg electron, if we can see a dipole moment. Now, this is the dipole moment as a function of the average number of perturbers. So, as I said, we are around 1,000 at 10 to the 16th, and this is the corresponding density of perturbers in the gas, or just the gas density. And you see, basically, this is percentiles now, because we, of course, we do this explicitly by hand. That means we make realizations of ground state atoms randomly, and of course, we have to average over them, yeah, over many of them, 10,000 or so. And so this is just percentage how far you're away from the mean. And you see, you build up your dipole moment. That means you build up your trilobite. This is what we saw before at roughly 10 to the 13th. You form them, yeah? And then the expectation is fulfilled. You lose the dipole moment. More and more perturbers. The poor Rydberg electron does not know with whom to get married, whatever. Yeah, so it's all orientations, it's gone. But of course, I wouldn't talk about this if this wouldn't change. If you go to higher densities, all of a sudden, it recovers. So here clearly you kind of form something, whatever it is, which has dipole moment again. And then it goes down again. We understand this kink. That's a special thing because of the system. Not so important. And it seems to recover here again. So what is that? So this is how it really looks like. So this is at the situation where the dipole moment has recovered. That's the true density of the Rydberg electron. So it looks a bit fragmented. So it had some rough time. But by and large, it really keeps its nice shape of the trilobite. Now, why is that? So this is now, again, our 10,000, our 1,000 atoms. And you can just turn this around for your amusement to see it from all sides. It really looks like a nice surface of probability density, which is structured. Here's, of course, our ion sitting. Now, why is that? The answer is very simple. The answer is the birthday paradoxon. So random is not as random as we think. You probably know this, that you know, if you have, I forget, 23 or 27 people in a room are enough that two of them have with 50 more than 50% probability birthday on the same day of the year. And that number is surprisingly low for us, just against our intuition. Same thing happens here at a certain density. There's quite a high probability, or let's say a sufficient probability, that these ground state atoms in our random gas are clustered. What means clustered? They need to be closer than half of the wavelengths of our Rydberg state in order that the Rydberg electron cannot resolve that anymore, right? But that means then at this position here, you have a double strength perturbation. Now the Rydberg electron knows again where to go to. And that's exactly what's happening here. And I think, Rick, this is also happening in your perturber-induced scarring. This determines really the orientation. You probably have things more close by compared to the high excitation, and this really determines in the end the orientation of the periodic orbits. Sorry, it was a side comment. Yeah. So here you see this again. This is magnified. And here you see the culprit. This is why it orients this way. Here you see these three ground state atoms, which have now been marked in yellow, so you recognize them, not in red. They are just by chance close by. They form such a cluster. And now you form a trilobite again, which is localized as a focal point, like the original single ground state atom on this perturbation of triple strength on that cluster of atoms. Yeah. Oh, really? Okay, that's bad because I got slower. And so this is then now the clusters are rare, but you need only one. And you see, this is a probability to have basically one of those triple clusters. And you see it goes up here sharply. And this is also where we see increasing of our revival, if you wish, of the trilobite. And of course, you can think what happens is you make it denser and denser, and eventually a quadruple or five cluster atom takes over, and you get another revival of that. Okay, so in the last couple of minutes, I want to tell you about the future, what we are just right now interested in. We wanted to study this a bit more systematically, how these perturber atoms in the Rydberg volume, how they influence the wave function. That means we put a lattice there where the Rydberg impurity is just one lattice side. And right now it's a planar lattice because of time reasons. That turns out the most interesting one to be because it breaks maximally the symmetry of our Rydberg manifold. And what we do now is, so this is basically the range of the Rydberg orbit. We put the atoms here, and when I say how many there are, that's basically this radius. And what we also do for technical reasons, to make it handable and also to understand it better, we take a constant scattering length, no more energetically dependent, which would become true if you go very, very high in excitation. And we can do this in the end because I will tell you we are after scaling relations. That means we can actually calculate in the n asymptotically large limit and scale it back to a finite n to get results which might matter in the experiment. So this is just a few snapshots. What matters here, we now fill this lattice randomly with atoms. This is just one atom. That gives us, of course, the trilobite. So our Rydberg impurity is sitting here. Here's this one atom. Then we fill it with 6%. It's gone, chaotic. Then we fill it 18%. You probably have some clustering here. 32%, 56%. And now, if you can guess, completely filled, you retrieve another kind of geometrical structure. This is what we had in the beginning. Yeah? And the reason is very simple. Here, it's basically a continuous density of perturbers. The Rydberg electron can no longer resolve, and it resembles more or less this situation where we put the atoms on the circle. And more than 58 do not matter. Yeah, and we can do it, of course, the other way around. We can say we now fill our lattice with a regularly spaced grid, and that means we simply fill every side, but we vary the lattice constant. That's shown here. So here, the lattice constant is very small. Again, so small that the Rydberg electron cannot resolve it. And now we go backwards. We make the lattice constant larger, larger. And here is as large as the bond length of our Rydberg system. And you see, you get basically a tetramer. Okay, how can one do this systematically? This is how it really looks like. That's the energy diagram. Yeah? So this is, as a function of lattice spacing for n equals 30, I think, here. And you see, there is much more structure than you think, at least in this limit where it gets homogeneous or continuous density. And this is also, I mean, all these individual things are gone. This is actually very interesting. We're studying this right now. But if you average here over a filling factor, and at each filling factor percentage, over 100 realizations, then it becomes quite regular again. But nevertheless, you get now bands. Yeah? You get energy bands for the single electron of a Rydberg electron, I mean, Rydberg orbit. And the question is, what are these bands? And the yellow part you see here, this is the participation ratio of the M quantum number. And this is kind of what matters here because of the symmetry, since we have a planar orbit. And I will tell you now in the last 2 minutes basically something about the spectrum in this limit of high density where basically the perturbation is continuous. And that's the last point. Yeah, we go now to this extremely high density. And this you see here, so we get energy levels as a function of the M quantum number which look like bands. And one band is actually separated from all the others. You see this here, this is the density of states. I come to this in a second. And of course, these are already scaled units, also come to that. And up here, you have overlapping bands. And here you see now the density of states, how this comes about. So we have basically, this is the energy. You can calculate this more or less analytically. This is not the whole part. That's a diagonal approximation, if you wish. We have left out non-diagonal terms in the matrix elements. But for the lower bands, that's quite good. And you see the lower edge in the plane, this is basically what gets perturbed by the plane. Plane scales like n to the minus 11 half. This you see by having here, I shouldn't talk so long, so you can get this from the formula. And so the band edge is also analytically given. And you see here for n equals 40, 70, 100, and we scale this here by n to the minus 11 half. So this is how the lower band edge scales, and you get this band perfectly already in scale. But you see the upper parts, they, of course, move apart because they don't respect the same scaling. And the black lines here are the energy levels from the bands I just showed you in the last transparency. And you see clearly how they overlap here. Yeah? And that's kind of the final thing. So we can actually have the other limit. We can scale the upper band edge. That's the bulk limit, n to the minus 6. For that, you don't have to think. This falls out of general considerations. This is a bit harder. That's not so easy to get. And now, of course, you can make a universal scaling function which interpolates between the two. Since you have a gap here, it's very easy. And you get a universally scaled density of states for the system up to high n, whatever you want. So this is, I think, as far as we have come now. So we do more on that, especially on the regular part. And of course, hope that some experimental colleagues will also be able to do this. They can make these lattices now. N equals 100. 150 is still a challenge, but it's probably possible to do that in the future. So the journey took you for Rydberg excitations in an environment of increasing density from a very small number of perturbers, which break the high degeneracy of the quantum Rydberg manifold and lead to a localization of electron quantum probability on classical periodic orbits of the unperturbed Rydberg system, and that leads to the formation of molecules. And that's a perspective I think we did not have 20 years ago. I mean, molecule formation, to view it in this way as localization of the Rydberg electron and so on, this comes from the perspective we have now. And then we had this intermediate regime of perturbation density relative to the extension of the Rydberg atom, where you lose basically all this regularity, at least as far as we know now. And in the high density limit, you have a reappearance of localization with different symmetries when the perturber can no longer, when the perturbers can no longer be resolved by the Rydberg wave function. All right? And in this case, also then energy bands appear with universal scaled density of states. And I showed you that this peculiar phenomenon that in a random gas, you actually retrieve the very simple structures due to the birthday paradoxon and the clustering of atoms if you have a suitable density of the gas or the BEC. And I'm sure this will be observed in due time. And with that, I'm at the end, and thank you for your patience.
Yeah, thanks a lot, Jan-Michel. That's very vivid